18. Yesterday we had 21 presentations by professors from different divisions under 5 major schools of IRI: crop improvement, crop protection, resource management, basic sciences, and horticulture sciences. In this session, we'll be having 5 presentations by Dr. Alka Singh from Astral Economics, Dr. R. N. Padaria from Agriculture Extension, Dr. C. Majeki from Agriculture Statistics, Dr. A. R. Rao from Bioinformatics, and Dr. Sudhir Marwa from Computer Applications. I now request Dean and Joint Director of Education IRI, Dr. Rajshmi Agarwal, for formal welcome.
Thank you, Rob. Good morning and a very warm welcome to all of you on this third day of Convocation Week. As mentioned, we are continuing with the professor's presentations on the significant educational achievements in the discipline of this in the School of Social Sciences today, which is the 6th session of this program. And there are total 38 theses to be presented. You will be glad to know that today we have with us Dr. P.K. Joshi, who is chairing this session. He is Director, South Asia International Food Policy Research Institute, New Delhi, and former Director, NAM, Hyderabad. Dr. S. Naresh Kumar, Professor, Discipline of Environmental Sciences, IRI, he will continue to be the convener of this session also. So first of all, I would like to request our Director, Dr. A.K. Singh, on behalf of faculty and students and staff of IRI, to welcome Dr. P.K. Joshi, the chief guest of today's function. On behalf of faculty and the students, and on my own behalf, we welcome Dr. A.K. Singh also on this, on the dais. So, let me introduce to the audience is about Dr. P.K. Joshi's contributions in the field of agriculture. Dr. Pramod Kumar Joshi is the Director of South Asia with the International Food Policy Research Institute. Previous to this, he held the positions of the Director of the NAM Hyderabad and the Director of the National Center for Agriculture Economics and Policy Research, New Delhi. Dr. Joshi has also served as the Chairman of SAARC Agricultural Center's Governing Body in India, in Dhaka, Bangladesh. Chairman of the UN CAPSA Governing Board in Bogor and member of the Intergovernmental Panel on the World Bank's International Assessment of Agricultural Science and Technology for Development. He served as a member of the International Steering Committee for the Climate Change, Agriculture and Food Security Challenge Program, led by the ESSP Science Community and the CGIAR. He was also a member of the core group of the Indian government's Right to Food National Human Rights Commission and the Secretary General of the 4th World Congress on Conservation Agriculture. Dr. Joshi is a recipient of a number of prestigious awards and honors and several other recognitions, including Dr. M.S. Randhawa Memorial Award of NAS, Professor R.C. Agarwal Lifetime Achievement Award of the Indian Society of Agricultural Economics, D.K. Desai Award of the Indian Society of Agricultural Economics, and R.T. Doshi Foundation Award of the Agricultural Economics Research Association for outstanding contribution in social science and agricultural economics research. He was the president of the Indian Society of Agricultural Economics and Indian Society of Agricultural Marketing in 2014 and Agricultural Economics Research Association in the year 2015. He is fellow of National Academy of Agricultural Sciences and the Indian Society of Agricultural Economics. So we are very delighted and thankful to you for accepting our invitation to chair this session on social sciences. Welcome you again, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I know request the convener of the session, Dr. Naresh Kumar, to kindly conduct the further proceedings.
Very good morning to all of you. Respected Chair, Dr. B.K. Joshi, sir, Dr. Director of the Institute, Dr. H.K. Singh, and Dean, Dr. Krishna Garwa, and the Joint Director of Research, former Dean, Dr. R.K. Jain, sir, Project Director, heads of the divisions, professors, dear friends, students, and faculty. Today we have a session, very important session on social sciences. Under this, as mentioned, five presentations are due. I request the professors to kindly stick to the time slot because our session must end by within time, by 10:45, so that the following sessions can be as per the schedule. Thank you very much.
Honorable Chairman, sir, respected Director, sir, Dean Mallow, Convener, Heads of Department, Professors, former Dean, PD, WTC, Joint Director Research, and dear colleagues and students. It's a proud moment for me to present before you the research work carried by the students who are going to take degree in this convocation. As far as the faculty students and courses status is concerned in our division of agriculture extension, we have 23 faculty, one new faculty have been added, and number of research guides are 13, and one more research guides have been added, and one we have adjunct faculty of former DDG extension, and number of courses we are offering that is 34, and total grades come to 99, including two of the most important course that is PGS 502, it is scientific and technical writing, other is PGS 505, it is related to rural development programs and research ethics. And we have also developed one new course as per the guidelines of PG School, that is on e-course on introduction to disaster management. And we have on roll 36 students and 13 are going to take degree, 5 from PhD and rest 8 from MSc. The first area of our division has been on development of extension model, entrepreneurship development, farmer-led innovations, gender empowerment and capacity building. Keeping in tune with this first area of division, the PG research was also tuned up. Since we are working more on doubling farmers' income, so entrepreneurship development has taken a great leap, and also some of the good works have been done under this area. Then other is human resource development, innovation and food production and safety. Under these four major headings, we shall be able to talk about some of the research findings. First was on critical analysis of entrepreneurial environment for value chain development by Shruti. And it is a proud moment to share that Shruti bagged the gold medal yesterday for her presentation under the dynamic leadership of Joint Research Center, Dr. Jyoti Sharma-ji. She wanted to work out how the processors and the producers are different. Using the semantic differential technique, she could find out that processors and the producers varied significantly differently in terms of different traits of entrepreneurship. And she also found out that as far as the food processors and vegetable processors are in one block, and food grain processors are quite distinctly different from these two. So ultimately, she has suggested there are significant differences between processor and producer, so the different kinds of entrepreneurship training should be conducted for them. And the net return was higher for processor as compared to producer, so how best we can enhance the benefit for the producers also. Market was the most preferred dimension for training need among the processors, and the driving force was higher for processor, but the restraining force for more for producer. It reflects that human dimension is quite important to be significant for entrepreneurship development. How you do that, positive outlook has to be there. The information dimension was ranked first for the promotion of value chain among the producers. So she recommended that there should be promotion of entrepreneurship behavior among the farmers as well as the small processors, and the entrepreneurship environment through institutional intervention should be strengthened, capacity building of farmers for linking with the ENAM, and encourage commodity and community-based processing at district centers through the Sampada scheme of Government of India, and then facilitate single builder delivery system for providing information to the potential entrepreneurs. So second study was related to how best our farmer producer companies are performing, and how the farmers can be linked with the market through the entrepreneurship as well as through organizational setup, institutional mechanism. Farmer producer companies have emerged in a significant manner. And Anirban, under the leadership of Dr. Priyanka, head of Agriculture Extension, he found out that there are significant differences between the farmers who are associated with the farmer producer companies and those who are not. And so to measure that, he has used several kinds of scale, and one was five-dimensional managerial development competency battery, which is uploaded at IRF PG School website so that the any individual can assess his managerial competency. And the attitude of the farmers towards farmer producer companies was also found significant. And the managerial competency under that proactive goal setting that was lacking and which need to be taken care of for extending of management function of farmer producer company. And accordingly, in the different kinds of farmer producer companies, these five dimensions of the management differed significantly, and according to the training programs should be conducted for the capacity building of the officials of farmer producer companies. The effectiveness was also measured, and he weighted through the analytical hierarchy process, and empowerment, sustainability, and farmer satisfaction were the key areas or key dimensions for effectiveness. And he also tried to find out what are the innovating and facilitating factors for farmer producer company success. And high tax liabilities and high cost of inputs, there's a major limitation. But dynamic leadership, hard work of members, and skill training, that was the facilitating factor. Other was how this integrated farming system model can cover up for doubling the farmer's income. And yesterday also there were talks, and students have also worked. So one of the students, he worked in Odisha and Jharkhand, where the livelihood and income generation is through integrated farming system model. It is found out from the study that location-specific components should be added rather than recommending as the different research institutions are recommending. It should be based on the local needs and local endowments of the farmers. Because in Jharkhand, most of the IFS was livelihood stock-based and livestock-based, but in Odisha it was pond-based. So what are the opportunities for the farmer that should be taken care of? And he also found out what are the determinants of pond-based farming. It is on area as well as the distance to the nearest plot. That is the major significant factors which cover determinants. Similarly, for diversification, it was again distance to the market and credit. That was another. So he has suggested strategies. Strategies are related to the productivity system approach of extension, convergence extension, looking beyond production, participatory on-farm approaches for model development. These are some of the suggestions he has given to promote integrated farming system. Other is how much our students are career-oriented and moving towards entrepreneurship. This is one of the students from Egypt under the leadership of Dr. Rashmi. She found out that the career aspirations of the students are more towards government jobs. that's the Lord graph it is showing, that most of the students are not so much of interested towards entrepreneurship. So how this entrepreneurship venture can be there among the students so that they may be more of the job providers rather than the job seekers. Other work was on use of instruction technology in agricultural education, again by under the leadership of head Dr. Premataji. And here the student found out that students are more savvy with the digital kinds of tools, and digital competency was better among the students than the faculty. And it needs that if you have to integrate ICT in education, certain kinds of capacity building for the teachers are required, particularly online modules as well as the e-learning modules, how to develop that. And some of the barriers are related to infrastructure and administrative, and teachers and students differ according to their barriers. Teachers suggested that infrastructure is the related barrier, but the student perceived that administrative barrier is more severe. Others was on capacity building as well, that is effectiveness of training in enhancing core competency of extension personnel. And first day, this student, Ashwarya presented for gold medal under the leadership of Dr. Monica. She has reflected that under core competencies, the conventional area like communication skills, subject matter expertise, that is not the training need. My major training need is on leadership, but in terms of trainers, it is related to use of ICT. And the factors related for adoption of this training need and other kinds of tools was locus of control and the job performance among the trainers. Other work was on gender empowerment, again for Warabi from Egypt under the leadership of Monica. And he has found out the significant difference between male and female related to ICT use and also gender empowerment because of ICT intervention. Other was on leadership style in scientific organization by Payam from Afghanistan under leadership of Dr. Monica. He has tried to identify the 16 leadership traits among the scientific organizations, and it is pooled under three: achievement, motivation, facilitative, and the technical competence. And he has also suggested how the innovative leadership practices can be given, like capacity building of subordinate staff, facilitating research collaboration, and delegation and accountability. The most of the kinds of innovations which is prevailing in our agriculture system is coming from the formal setup, but also the informal setup is contributing a lot for innovation generation. So one of the study was conducted by Gangubai, that was innovations in agriculture, knowledge creation, information management and technology delivery system under the leadership of Dr. J.P. Sharma, joint director research, extension, sorry. And they have found out that the different kinds of institutions have the different kinds of knowledge creation system, information management and technology delivery. And it was suggested that when the farmers are poor or the land size is low, they often resort to the NGOs and the other kinds of sources rather than the main sources of information. So different kinds of concepts also identified. Based on that, it was suggested that if the opportunities are there, recognition of innovative farmers or engagement of the farmers laboratory or the on-farm field trials at the institute level, more of the innovations can be tapped from the informal sector. There was one kind of good study that is on contemporary water management innovation, how the community-based innovations are coming in good shape in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. And they have tapped that if the community-based kinds of innovations are there, the water management innovations, harvesting, saving, and all will be better. And they have also suggested that there should be more on social institutions and convergence approach for extension, and the travel workshop to sensitize the farmers of drought-hit villages, how they can conserve water locally and use it and share it properly. Pesticide application is becoming a menace for the health part. So under food safety, the pesticide use behavior of vegetable farmers were carried by Dr. Jasna and the leadership of Dr. Premlata. They have found out that under cauliflower, it's fine, but little cabbage and brinjal and bottle gourd, bitter gourd, there are substantial use of pesticide, and that's why this differed significantly among the different vegetables. So they have also found that the farmers have their separate plots for their own consumption as well as for the marketing. So these are the avenues where the certain kinds of interventions are required to sensitize farmers. So and how consumers are doing that, consumers were willing to pay around 24% to 31% higher than the normal price to get pesticide residue free vegetables. But the sensitization level of the extension and the farmer do not match up. So how the extension agencies can take up to sensitize farmers about the safe pesticide use that is to be taken care of. And one was on oil organic food, how the consumers are perceiving about the organic food, and this was the study conducted by Tanishtha under the leadership of Satyakriya. And they found that there was a medium level of knowledge about the organic food system among the farmers as well as the consumers, and they prefer that if it is good for health, they would like to go for organic food. And the strategy suggested is there should be some kinds of authentic certification, and prices should be brought down, and the demonstrations should be conducted among the farmers for cultivating this organic vegetables and other kinds of crops. Then the food mapping is ultimately the kinds of purpose, because we have to move towards nutrition security now, and also at present we are facing some of the kinds of food insecurity. So one of the study was taken by Manjunath and the leadership of Dr. Savita. They found out that it's not only the area, age, gender that is variable which is related to food consumption behavior, sir, and even the type of tribe that is also instrumental in deciding the food consumption pattern. Like we can see that Chenchu and Burmas, they do not take milk in their diet. That is another kinds of tribes setup and mindset that needs to be taken care of. So in food mapping, it's not only the availability of food and the what is the gap in production. Besides that, how the consumption behavior is there among the community, that also need to be taken care of. So HRD initiatives are under that we have conducted three training programs for the extension professionals. And research papers are 8, training manual 2. 4 students have joined ARS out of 7. All are 5 are PhD, 2 are going to abroad after completing the degree. And faculty engagement was again at Myanmar. 9 faculty visited AGAIR for giving the capacity building to the students there under ICR's AGAIR program. And Dr. Arun Raman coordinated the development of ICT-based extension at AGAIR. We also participated in national and international event. Dr. Sangeeta participated at Vancouver on Food and Nutrition Security International Conference. And there was I also attended at first SAR Cooperative Business Forum at Nepal. And awards were galore for our faculty. And our students are pride. One of our students bagged the Jawaharlal Nehru Award, Dr. Hema. And last year, Ms. Kriti bagged the IRI's Best Event Award. And this is the third consecutive Jawaharlal Nehru Award for our division. And yesterday, Suti bagged, day before yesterday, Suti bagged PhD gold medal. This is the sixth consecutive gold medal for our division. And the students have been going to abroad and also nationally for presenting their output of the work. And some of the students have presented at Kalahandi Dialogue. And I acknowledge the contributions and guidance by Dr. IRI, Dean and Joint Director Education, Joint Director Research and Extension, PG School, heads of Head and Faculty Students of Agriculture Extension, and all my students. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for excellent presentation. You covered a wide range of issues the students have taken up. I think he needs a bigger effort. Thank you very much. Now it's my pleasure to invite Dr. Atra Singh for Agriculture Council.
Very good morning to all of you, esteemed chair of the session, director IRI, dean and joint director of education, other dignitaries of the dais, Dr. Naresh Kumar, convener of the session, all the faculty members and my dear students. I stand before you for presentation of significant educational achievement for the discipline of agricultural economics. So to begin with, in our division we have 43 students of 10 MSc and 33 PhD students. This year, 3 MSc and 4 PhD students are graduating, and placement of the students, Agriculture Research Services, 4 students have joined this year, and 2 students have joined in research positions of agriculture universities. Then RBI and NABARD, 3 students have joined, and 2 joined in the State Department of Agriculture. And I'm pleased to inform that in this year also for Agriculture Research Services, most of our PhD students have qualified for the written examination. Regarding students' publication, we have this year 15 publications after students' work, and faculty, we have 15 faculty, 6 faculty from NIA. NEAP also. And in this year, we have newly admitted faculty of two. One is from Division and one from NEAP. And we have in all 9 research guides. The mandate of the division includes postgraduate education along with training programs in frontier areas of agriculture, economics, policy research. Our student research themes centered around in 3 main areas, that is technology, resource and environment, agricultural markets and value chain, institutional innovations and rural livelihood. This is a list of the graduating students, 3 MSc and 4 PhD, along with thesis title and the respective chairpersons. To begin with, this piece of work based on national sample survey unit level data on employment, unemployment and migration. This analyzes the pattern of rural migration and its major determinants. Then effect of migration and regulations on agriculture productivity and impact of government schemes on labor migration from agriculture. So this basically reveals that basically male migrants dominated the temporary migration category, and mostly the intra-state migration is there. Out of the total migration, 79% are the intra-state, and interstate migration is 21%. Most of the intra-state migrants are within the rural areas, that is within the district, and migration rate was seen higher in western and northeastern regions. Analysis which shows that who are the most likely to opt for migration, that suggests that age group of between 15 and 45 are likely to migrate more. Similarly, for married individuals, households with large family size, then individuals with low education level, migrant, marginal landholders and agricultural laborers, they are more likely to opt for the migration. The study was substantiated with the primary data also in Jhansi and Tikamgarh districts of UP and Madhya Pradesh, that is basically Bundelkhand region, which is more subjected to drought and poverty stricken situation, and very recurrent droughts are there. So more of out migration for short term is there. This study shows, that is the effect of migration on remittances, shows that a percent household receiving remittances are 55%, and the average remittances they received is approximately 3,342, and most of the households spent remittances on consumption followed by education, and a quarter of households also spent on agricultural activities, which is an encouraging sign. And the major pull factors for these migration were identified as better employment opportunities, wage differences and educational and health facilities. And when we just compared the productivity of agricultural crops in migrants and non-migrant households, it was found that the productivity was higher on non-migrant households, and the difference was attributed towards the management of farms on non-migrant households. And education and farming experiences, as well as access to irrigation, was proved to be improving the productivity. The impact of government schemes, basically Bundelkhand package and Manrega, were found to be significantly impacting that those which is reducing opting for the migration. So that is a kind of encouraging sign that these packages and programs are helpful in mitigating the distress in the region. Another study, which was also presented for gold medal presentation, identified climate smart agriculture technologies impact. Basically in Haryana and Bihar, that is Indo-Gangetic Plain, and they this assess this extent of adoption and factors affecting for adoption of climate smart agriculture technologies and farmers' perception as well as impact, and also the assess the impact of credit for facilitating that adoption. So here these 7 technologies were taken into consideration, and it was found that when technology adoption index was higher as the farm size increases, and it was also found higher in case of Haryana as compared to Bihar, and the factors influencing adoption were found as farm size, organization membership, credit and training imparted to them. Two main technologies were studied in detail, that is laser land leveler and zero tillage, and they were just considered versus with conventional tillage practices, and it was found that there is incremental yield in case of wheat and paddy both in Bihar and Haryana through PSM technique, and water saving, electricity saving and carbon emission reduction was also estimated. Similarly, there was superiority of zero tillage technology, which was much more adopted in BR as compared to Haryana also just gave a reduction in cost and impact on yield also. And once this targeted model, this also confirmed that once there is a larger scale adoption of CSA technology in the region, it has capacity to increase returns as well as reduction in risk. So this confirms that adoption of CSA technologies basically reduces risk and increases profitability. It was also mentioned in the study, it was pointed out that farmers should be apprised of various tangible and intangible benefits of these technologies so that they can be convinced and about its importance and that can be upscaled. Another study on drip irrigation in northern Maharashtra in two districts of Jalgaon and Nasik was done, and a comparison between drip irrigation and flood irrigation was there. And here the impact of drip irrigation on water productivity, profitability and social cost and benefit was also evaluated. And it was found that adoption of drip irrigation was more on the large farms, hence it should be made more inclusive, and organization membership, operated area, groundwater depth and cultivation of more of the commercial crops, they are just having more adoption of drip irrigation. Some of the constraints were found out, like higher initial investments, clogging of depots, and lack of capital to cover the entire holding, and delay in sanction of loan, and unstable and complex kind of drip irrigation subsidies were cited as main factors. When it was seen on the impact of water productivity and profitability on sugarcane and banana, two main cash crops of the region, it was found that yield as well as net income both were higher on drip irrigated farms as compared to the flood one. Regarding the inclusion of social cost and benefit along with the other financial cost and benefits, it was found that social benefit cost ratio turned out to be 2.08, that it is beneficial even accounting for the environmental as well as benefits as well as cost. So it was concluded that efforts should be directed to enhance adoption of drip irrigation by all categories of farmers, especially in water scarce regions, and address the financial concerns regarding sanction of loans and timely release of subsidy for its speedy adoption by all categories of farmers. The next study relates to the value addition, as value addition has been termed as a major tool for enhancing farmer income and stabilizing prices. So the study was done in Andhra Pradesh for tomato, which is a major producer of tomato, and Chittoor and Anandpur district were selected. These two, both of these two districts are major grower of tomato. Only the difference is that in Chittoor, there are a lot of fruits and vegetable processing units are there, whereas in case of Anandpur, they are not. So we just try to assess that what are the cost and returns of tomato value addition by these processing units and impact of value addition on farm income. So here five units were selected with different capacity utilization. So it was there that the number of capacity on which these farms are operating are not many, ranging from 50 to 95 in a year. Regarding the economics of tomato processing, it was found that benefit cost ratio is financially viable and profitable, and farmer share in tomato paste was 68%, tomato price was 68%, and profit margin of processor in tomato paste price was around net 10%. And some of the constraints faced by processors was raw material availability in terms of quality as well as quantity in the vicinity, fluctuations in the price of raw material, labor availability and marketing kind of things. Then some of the other salient findings which include the comparison of marketing channel, and the major marketing channel is tomato is procured from the regulated markets through traders, not directly by the farmers. And more than 90% of tomato paste was sold to the domestic processing units, and only 4% is exported to different countries. Cost of cultivation was also worked out, and it was found that this was very financially feasible. Value chain financing for quinoa, which is another important crop of the northwestern India, was also assessed. And here it was found that medium farmers were found more technically efficient and as compared to the large as well as small farmers. And here other financial indicators are visible, and they are having more profitability as compared to the conventional cotton wheat production system. Impact of a value chain financing on was identified in terms of strong value chain and weak value chain. In a strong value chain, a number of intermediaries are higher, but here you can see that net benefit per rupee of investment is also higher, because here price risk and market risk as well as yield risk are also less as compared to a weak value chain where less number of intermediaries are there. Some of the suggestions to improve value chains were also prescribed. Then another study on farmers producers organization was done in the state of Telangana, and here impact of FPO on farmers technology adoption, market access, finance and income was assessed, and it was found that basically higher growth of FPO, though it is coming in now in eastern states, but still more concentration is in southern states, and these are the some of the influencing factors like promoting institutions, ease of doing business, markets and literacy rate, they are more relevant for promoting FPO in the region. Then impact of technology adoption in Chile, those who are members of FPO, those who are not, were assessed, and it was found that technology adoption was more on beneficiary farms, and impact on income and yield was also more on those farmers who have joined FPOs, and here they are also more technically efficient. They are found. Then it was also highlighted that in activities like in production and marketing activities, many of the farmers' participations are there, but not in organization building kind of activities. This last study, this basically relates to the Jivika program which Bihar government is implementing, and here main initiatives relate to the institution building, social development, microfinance and livelihood, and here the main message was that those districts who were adopted in Jivika, by Jivika, in first phase, they have the higher penetration of microfinance. And when they were deeply analyzed, that is Gaya and Muzaffarpur, who are where more penetration is there, the sustainability of these SSGs are also found higher, and homogeneity of the group and share of the members and the motivation by the given by the ground staff of Jivika were the main identified factors for their sustainability. Socioeconomic transformation was also evident in those Jivika beneficiary farms. Regarding the recognition of student research, sir, I am proud to say that our two PhD students, they bagged Majumdar Best Paper Award as well as Best Paper Award by Indian Society of Agricultural Economics. One of our students has also participated in the 30th International Conference of Agricultural Economics at Canada and presented paper. Apart from Dr. C. Subramaniam Award, our young scientists have also bagged N.A. Majumdar Award in this conference. Sir, with your generous guidance and support, many of our scientists also presented paper in 30th International Conference of ICAE in Canada, and one Akriti Sharma, she presented paper in Netherlands in one conference. Apart from the academic activities, our students are also participating in institutional building activities, like one of our students was Academic Council representative last year, and this student is now MSc second year DGSSU incumbent, and two students, they have also been elected as president and then state secretary for ISA, and apart from that, they have bagged various laureates for extracurricular activities. We organized two CAF training programs in the division in frontier areas, and other activities like guest lectures, brainstorming, and our students this time have also got for the study tour to ICAR institutes in Rajasthan. And apart from that, since our most of the faculty are in younger age group, so we have also invested resources and time for their capacity building, and in these kind of leading areas, they have developed their capacity. And with this, I just thank you one and all for strengthening PG research in the discipline. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. for excellent presentation, and thank you very much for excellent presentation. We have already covered a range of issues and all the topical interest. So I think we deserve much bigger. Thank you.
Good morning to all and welcome to this session. I am here to present the significant educational achievements from the discipline of agricultural statistics. And here, till now, the total number of students that have passed out in this discipline are 561 as on date, and the students on roll are 45. The students who will be getting degree in this convocation, total 10 students are there, 3 PhD and 7 MSc. And the broad areas of research which we cover is as per the mandate of the institute to undertake basic and applied research in agricultural statistics, to conduct postgraduate teaching and in-service customized training programs. And the broad areas are designing of experiments and development of analytical techniques for experimental data analysis, then sample surveys for parameter estimation, statistical modeling and forecasting, and then the spatial statistics, which includes the geoinformatics and spatial modeling. So bifurcation of these 10 students are, 5 students have worked in the area of design of experiments, 2 in sample surveys, 2 in statistical modeling and forecasting, and 1 in spatial statistics. This is the list of the students who will be getting the degree. These are 3 PhD students. Out of these 3 PhD students, 2 of them have worked in the area of design of experiments and 1 in the area of sample surveys. And 7 MSc students. And this, the first one has worked on statistical modeling, and then the second one on design of experiments. Another one on design of experiments, sample survey. And this is a Mr. Kapil Chaudhary, a proud student of ours, who has got the IRI Merit Medal and will be getting it in this competition. He has worked in the area of the statistical modeling. Then another one is on response surface designs, and then one on spatial statistics, which is on soil health assessment using spatial statistics. Then total faculty strength is, we have 38 faculty members, out of which the 20 are the research guides. And besides this, we have Dr. E.K. Bhatia as our adjunct faculty, the former director of ISRI. Then there are 5 faculty members who have dual faculty membership, that is, they are also the faculty member of bioinformatics. 6 new faculty members have been added during this time, and 2 of the faculty members left us, one on deputation and the other one has been transferred to other institute. Total number of courses which we offer is 42, and there is one compulsory course, PGS 504, which all the students of IRI have to take, and it is offered in all the 3 trimesters of the academic session. Now I come to the significant achievements, the research achievements by the students, and again I'll be presenting it in the theme wise. The first one is on design of experiments. So as I told, there are 5 students who have worked in the area of design of experiments. So the first one is the work which is being done, which has been done on the multi-response experiments, that is, from one particular experimental unit we get more than one response. And in this particular case is an incomplete multi-response, that is, there are some subset of plots from where we get the response from only few variables, and there are another subset from where we get the response from other variables. So this gives rise to an incomplete multi-response. Further, because of some maybe diseases or weeds or so, there may be certain plots which are behaving differently than the other plots. So that means the response which we obtain from these plots are either abnormally very high or it's abnormally very low. So these type of observations we call it as outliers. So because of presence of these outliers, many of the assumptions which have to be followed, they get violated. So in order to deal with these type of outliers, the first is we have to detect those outliers. So entire methodology has been developed in terms of development of Cook statistics and AP statistics, which we call them, for identification of outliers in case of a block design setting. And the same has been illustrated with the real data. Then there is a case of multiple outliers, and when there is multiple outliers, the presence of one outlier is masked by the presence of the other outlier. So in this situation also, methodology has been developed to detect the outliers. Then the problem of outliers can be tackled by adopting a design which is robust against the presence of outliers. So a robustness criteria has been proposed for the block design, in case of incomplete multi-response experiments. Then coming to the next is the second one, efficient designs for incomplete factorial treatment structure. As we all know, factorial experiments, they help us to give us the effects of some main effects as well as the interaction effects. So in many practical situations, it is not possible to include all the treatment combinations in the experiment, especially in the clinical trial of situation where we have the placebo type of situation, and it is not possible to have this, such type of treatment combinations. So we have to delete these treatment combinations from the total number of combinations. So that means if we have two factors with M1 and M2 levels, so we are left with M1, M2 minus one treatment combinations. So for these situations, we have developed certain, the student has developed a optimal completely randomized designs for three factors, excluding triple placebo or both double and triple placebo. Then to deal with this type of situation or to obtain the designs, an algorithm has been developed, and for two factors with arbitrary number of levels. Now the same algorithm has been implemented using the SAS software, and the program was written on in the SAS, and the same is now made available. The layout of the entire designs are available online on the institute website, and this is just the snapshot of that that particular module. Then also efficient non-proper block design. Non-proper block design means the designs with unequal block sizes. So another method has been developed for this type of situations. Then the third work, which is done in statistical designs for fitting response surfaces. As we know, response surfaces are another important type of designs where we study the relationship between the explanatory variables and the response variable. So normally the observations which we assume in the response surface are independent, but there may be situations when our experimental units may experience some neighbor effects, that is, there is some effect coming from the adjacent units. So for this type of situation, some response surface designs have been developed with the differential neighbor effects. And further, the work has been extended to neighbor effects coming from the experimental units at distance 2. So all these designs developed, they ensure that the variance of the predicted response is constant. That is, the designs are rotatable. So this is that particular SAS program which has been developed for online generation of these response surface designs for easy accessibility of the users. Then the fourth work, which is on block designs for comparing test treatments with controls. So there are certain situations when the interest of the experimenter is in making comparison between the treatment, one set of treatments with another set of treatments, which are called as standard treatments. So for this type of situations, in the literature, there are already developed designs which are called as balanced treatment incomplete block designs and balanced bipartite block designs for single control treatment and for multiple control treatments. The student here has developed a nearly balanced treatment incomplete block designs and nearly balanced bipartite block designs. And this is again done using the algorithmic approach, and this algorithm has been implemented using the R programming language. And from this, 635 nearly BTIB designs and 886 nearly balanced bipartite designs have been listed. Then I come to the fifth one, the response surface designs for 4 and 6 levels. The most of the designs available for fitting the response surfaces, they are for the 3 level or 5 level. But there are many situations when we require the response surface designs for factors with 4 levels as well as 6 levels. So for this, nearly rotatable second order response, for fitting the second order response surface designs for 4 equispaced and 6 equispaced levels, the designs have been developed. Then the methods given, the developed method is general in nature and it can be for any number of factors. And for all these designs which have been developed, the another important property of response surface is the rotatability. So the rotatability measure has been worked out for all this, and a catalogue of these designs are made. Then now I come to the sample survey, where two of the students have worked in the area of sample survey. So the first one is use of calibration approach in the estimation of domain total. So here if we have the information on the auxiliary variable, so this will help us in getting the more precise estimation of population parameters.
So whenever this is available, the calibration approach is used for estimation of the population parameters. Further, there are certain subgroups or subpopulations which we call it as domain. So we have to estimate certain domain parameters. So the calibration approach has been used for estimation of domain parameters. And for this complete information, there are different situations which have been considered. First one is the complete information is available for one auxiliary variable, whereas it is not available for the other auxiliary variables. Then there are some known and unknown domain sizes, the type of correlation between the auxiliary variables. These different situations have been considered, and the expressions for these proposed estimators have been worked out along with the variance estimation formulas. And it has been empirically shown that the proposed estimators perform better. Then another work has been done on estimation of harvest and post-harvest losses, which is very important, and normally we find that these type of losses occur while transportation, storage and processing. So in order to deal with this, a methodology for estimation of harvest and post-harvest losses has been developed using the double sampling approach. And then the methodology provided estimates of percentage loss, variance and estimate of area. Then soil health assessment using spatial statistics. Again, soil health is very important for crop production. So for this, the spatial variability of soil attributes was captured, and the kriging was done, and the exponential model was found to be the best. And this was illustrated using the data obtained from PIKAR. And a soil health index has been developed. And the soil health index map was generated to assess the soil health. Then we come to the broad topic of statistical modeling and forecasting, where two students have worked. The first one is on wavelet and long memory time series model for forecasting. And this is for the situation when there is high volatility in the price data, and there is also a long memory or long range discrepancy among the data. So for this type of situation, normally a FEMA model is used, but there are certain situations where there are certain irregular parts. So for deal with this, a wavelet transformation approach has been used to deal with such situations. Then the last one is the study on empirical mode decomposition based neural network for agriculture price forecasting. This work will be has been awarded the IRI Merit Medal. In this case, whenever series is complex, so what do we do is we divide the series into different components, which are called here the intrinsic mode functions, and then different type models are fitted individually to these components, and then these components are finally combined, and a final forecast model, value is given. So now I come to the awards of the students. One of our students, Dr. Anandita Jetta, got the last year they got the one PhD and MSc, they got the IRI Merit Medal. Then one of the students got Dr. G.R. Seth Memorial Young Scientist Award 2018. Then one student, another Dipankar Mitra, got Nehru Memorial Gold Medal of the Institute. The Rima Singh, she received the Best Paper Award in Student Section in the Society, Indian Society of Agricultural Statistics. Then there was a presentation which was in Hindi, which was held in the institute during the Hindi Pakwara celebrations. Rahul Banerjee, Kapil Chaudhary and Jitendra Kumar, they bagged the first, second and third prize in this presentation. Then for doing good work in Hindi, one of our students got the Krishi Vigyan Gaurav. And the award to the faculty, I got the honor of getting the Punjab Rao Deshmukh Women Scientist Award. Then Dr. L.M. Bhatt has received the Best Paper Award. Dr. Simi, Dr. Seema and Dr. Rajendra, their joint paper, received the Best Paper Award. Dr. A.K. Paul and Dr. Himadri Ghosh, they also got the Best Paper Award. Dr. A.R. Rao and Dr. Hukum Chandra, they have been awarded the Fellow of Indian Society of Agricultural Statistics. Rajiv Kumar Paul is the NAST Fellow and also got the Best Paper Award. Dr. Arpan Bhomik, he got the Young Scientist Award. Then the foreign trainees, Dr. Anil Rai, Dr. Kofi Ahmed, they all visited under a consultancy project of the FAO. Dr. Hukum Chandra also visited Tanzania and Myanmar under different assignments. Dr. Vishal Gurung is on deputation for 2 years to Bhutan. And Dr. Arpan Bhaumik, Kausto Pradeep, they also visited Costa Rica and Nepal under different assignments. This is the total publications from the faculty. We have 82 publications from the faculty, and from the student side we have 21 publications, and few of the journals are just listed here, the important ones. Then the trainings which we have organized during this period is 11 training programs, as ISRI is the Center of Advanced Faculty Training, so we have organized 3 under that, 1 winter school, 2 under the consultancy board. These are those CAF training programs, and this is the training program which we had organized for the ISS officials, the medium and senior level ISS officials, and this is the training under HRM. Then we also organized certain other activities. The students went for the study tour to Rajasthan, and this is the extracurricular activities of our students. They have participated in various literary, cultural and sports activities. And this is the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan of the Government of India, where our students, they participated, they organized certain street plays in this, and then they also participated in debate, composition, poster making and all this. And these are other extracurricular activities in which the students have participated. And this is the last one, the student placement. 4 of our students have got selected in Indian Statistical Service. And 2 are in the Central State Board, and 1 has got the job in the multinational company.
Various aspects of statistics, experimental design, sampling, and also modeling aspects. Very, very simply, you have directed everything. Thank you very much, and congratulations to all the awards. It's a pleasure to invite Dr. A.R. Rao on bioinformatics.
This is regarding ours is the youngest discipline in IRI. The MSc program in bioinformatics has started in 2011-12 and PhD in 2014-15. And around 20 MSc students and 1 PhD student have already been awarded degrees. This year in this convocation, 3 MSc students and 1 PhD will be given degrees. And at present, we have a strength of 9 MSc students and 17 PhD students. This will cover different years. This is the faculty drawn for running this discipline from IRI, ISRI, NRC, and Plant Biotechnology, and NBPGR. We have a total faculty strength of 19, and eligible research guides are 17, out of which 7 are meant for PhD guidance. In total, 35 courses have been offered, and total credit hours of 101 and theory of 69 and practicals 32 credits. And the PhD student Tanmay, this year he will be getting degree. Ankita, Dipro, and non-law MSc students, they got their degrees. And broadly, the bioinformatics, the students' achievements have been put under broadly 3 themes, that is computational biology, genomics, and transcriptomics. Coming to the theme 1, the basic research gap is that this particular topic chosen was on foot and mouth disease, which is a painful disease in animals, especially in cattle and buffalo. Rapid development of effective vaccines and therapeutic solutions is highly essential in controlling this epidemic. But due to variable length of B cell epitopes, it is difficult to predict epitopes with higher accuracy, and moreover, in silico designing of synthetic antibodies will be, there has not yet been fully explored, and also role of non-coding RNAs in host-pathogen interactions, they have not yet been studied. Keeping this in mind, these objectives have been taken to develop a new procedure for epitope prediction and to propose a novel antibody for giving the therapeutic solution and to study the effect of non-coding RNAs in host pathogen interactions and to develop a web interface giving solutions to foot and mouth disease control. So this is the whole flow diagram. Basically, the false and true epitope data sets are to be considered for giving any training, you know, to develop a training model. So in this aspect here, machine learning approaches like ANN, SVM and random forest were used, and also different feature vectors have also been featured, that is the variables have been selected. So this feature vectors as well as the machine learning approaches together have been tried and identified with the procedure which will be giving highest prediction accuracy that has been tried on the independent data set of FMDV, and then finally using this prediction model, a web server has been developed. So this is how if you give different different peptide sequences, their probability of being B cell epitope or not, that probability will be given to the user. Or you can also submit a number of protein sequences, and out of that the probable epitopes will be predicted and given to you. So that is the user point of view, it will be useful. And then this is how this monoclonal antibody 4C4, this antibody here in this region, the antigen antibody interaction will take place, and sometimes there are many variants of this antigen comes out. In order to have best binding energy, the mutations are to be required, which needs to be tried over on this antibody. So that has been done, and we have identified around 18 paratope positions in this particular antibody. This is how this pipeline will be. This has been used to find out the binding and interaction energy of antigen and antibody. So if you look at this picture, visual inspection, this is a name-based model where the antigen and antibody interaction is taking place. But with the modifications or with the mutations in the antibody, this antigen got squeezed, and this best fitted to the in a best manner, this is being docked to the site. And also, when it is being tried, there are 9 miRNAs of BOS taurus which got targets in FMDV virus. This is how these around 300 targets have been identified for the miRNAs mainly present in the BOS taurus. And based on all this information, an information system called as foot and mouth disease information system has been developed for easy implementation to the user. And it is also available at our website at ISRI. So the salient findings that I have already mentioned, just I will skip this one. And the second student, main research gap is, she worked on this black pepper, which is also called as the king of spices. And here the whole genome sequence of black pepper is not yet available. And also doubt is one of the main abiotic stresses that results in reducing the productivity and crop loss. And so this transcriptome profiling has been done when there is some drought stress is been given. These are the three objectives she has taken up. And this is the methodology or pipeline followed for targeting the study. And mainly we have identified differential expression genes and also SSRs and SNPs and indels, which can be used as markers in the later stage for crop improvement. And this is the development of a database based on this what is called as black pepper drought transcriptome database. It is also available on ISRI website. And another student worked on this metagenomic study. The main research gap is that normally the principal component approach is used for making groups, and here correspondence analysis, this has not been yet used, so this has been tried upon to go for the reduction in dimensionality. And after that, little effort was made in applying the ensemble based clustering while making bins in the metagenomics data. So with these two objectives, the study has been taken up, and the results show that of course, with this workflow, So initially metagenomic sequence data has been taken and then assembly has been done, GC percentage and hexanucleotide frequencies have been computed, and based on the dimensionality reduction, bootstrapping has been done. After that, ensemble clustering methods have been followed. And this evaluation has also been done, and finally we came out with these seven groups of seven clusters distributed over these different number of microbes. So there is a method called RAND index value, which was found to be 0.78. Higher the value, the most will be the accuracy will be the clustering. So this is another one called in right-side maze. The main research gap was very little information was available on non-BDNAs in these two crops. So attempt has been made to develop a database on these non-BDNA forms. So this is the three-layered architecture has been adopted for finding the information. And in rice and maize, we found that most of them are of these non-BDNA forms are of type like this inverted repeats and cruciform motifs. This is what the finding says. And faculty awards, this has been already mentioned. Dr. Sarika received a NAS associate, and this is Ritika, who got this Jawaharlal Nehru Memorial Medal by IASRI, and she also published a very good paper in NAS Rated Journal out of her thesis work. And our students have also participated in sports activities, and this even in IRI, many competitions they won medals. And these are the students' participation in various conferences. We have published more than 10 last year, around 6 papers we published, and 9 to 10 or above 8 to 10, we published around 10 papers, and below 8, you can see the number of papers cutting across different journals like Scientific Reports, DNA Research, PLOS One, and many more journals we published, which are of international repute. And these are the training programs. And I just close this here. Thank you very much. My acknowledgments to one and all who are directly or indirectly involved in making this significant achievements. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Rao, for your excellent presentation. Very young division and this emerging division. A lot of work, including in health. Thank you very much. So again, give a big hand to Dr. Rao. We should not be miser and clapping, because you know, also kiss your heart. And now it's my pleasure to invite Dr. Sudeep Marwa, who will be presenting on computer applications. Dr. Marwa,
respected dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, and my dear students, I will be presenting the most significant achievements in the discipline of computer application. This year we are having 4 MSc students and no PhD students who are taking degree. These are the main 4 MSc students that have worked on different topics. Mainly the theme areas which we have worked on are the geoinformatics, software development for bioinformatics, and application development. These 3 theme areas students have opted. We have some other theme areas which we are not shown here because none of those students have done their work in those areas. First, geoinformatics. Dr. Chaudhary, under the guidance of Dr. Anshu Bhardwaj, worked on GIS approach for mapping the mega environment for maize in India. This work was presented in the student's work. Here the motivation was that projections of environment change are motivating greater emphasis on future constraints to agriculture production. The pace of population, climate and environment change has compelled the crop community to consider those stresses that are likely to result in significant declines. So our crop mega environment is one of the important area where one can find that how to basically take the genetic variability along with the climate change and soil and land cover, etc. So she has worked on this decision matrix for kharif maize and worked out where this decision matrix can be presented into a GIS map.
This is the decision matrix for the Ravi Maze, and finally it has published on the, she has published in the GeoServe, which is available at the Krishi portal of ICR. This is the methodology of one by one, how we can publish that on the GIS server. These are different snapshots, and these are the maps basically generated for the mega environment, for the Kharif maze, and then for the Rabi maze. So this mega environment, once we know it, that it, better planning of the crop can be done, and which further leads to the market intelligence and so forth. This is the server and address where it can be taken from. The next is the software development in the bioinformatics. Two students worked on this area. Development of web-based tool for visualization of genetic variants. Mr. Vivek Kumar, under the guidance of Dr. Anu Sharma. The motivation behind this work was to, in recent years, the increasing amount of genomic data have become available. The size, type and structure of these data have also been growing at an enormous rate. At present, for visualization of researchers' own data, in browser it is difficult and time consuming task. So it is necessary to minimize these problems by automating all activities which are performed by researcher before the data can be visualized on the genome browsers. This work aims to develop an integration of genetic variants in the genome browser on web. So this browser will help users to access and study genetic variants and its associated information through a single window interface. This is the architecture of the software. Three tier architecture has been developed, which use latest technologies available right now. Interaction will happen like this, and so this is the home page of this particular software, which is web-based tool for genetic variation. And you can see in this software you can have a genetic variation such as SNPs are shown, and various file formats can be used, FASTA, BAM, or different GFF3 and BAM. Conclusion that the developed browser has a functionality to upload an annotated file by automating the underlying process. Browser has functionality to automatically configure the process to visualize the contents into the browser. Browser can generate the files compatible with other existing browsers and convert data into different file formats. And it will also help the researchers to visualize the genetic variants for their generated data without undergoing the lengthy process or writing their own programs. Next student worked on development of software prototypes for in silico copy number variation identification. He Vaidyanath under the guidance of Dr. S.B. Lal. The motivation behind this work was that several standalone open source tools are available for detection of CNV implants. Few commercially tools are also available, but these tools need to be run on individual machines and which require installation and knowledge of art, which we find a little bit different for some researchers. So a web-based application with a user-friendly interface for detection of CNV assessing online database would be highly beneficial for the researcher. So by this motivation, this software has been developed, and standard C-tier architecture has been used, and R has been integrated in the web-based software, and the database is used. Here is MySQL, and rest of the state-of-the-art technology which are available right now has been used. So this is the home page of that software, copy number variation identification. This is a result file, which is a text file generated from the software, which provides basically functionality to generate text file containing different information like chromosome number, start position of CNV, end position, size of CNV, position of CNV, depth of the reference chromosomes per window, depth of the target chromosomes per window, and copy number ratio of a particular chromosome. So basically this software will provide an easy identification of CNV for various states that can greatly enhance the crop improvement programs. The next theme was the mobile application development. Under this, Lakshmi Sonkale, under the guidance of Dr. Sangeeta Ujjawal, this is the design and development of mobile app for economic assessment of drudgery prone activities in agriculture. So since we know that agriculture is one of the drudgery prone occupations, due to the lack of access to improved agriculture technologies, and the evaluation of agriculture activities and tools on the basis of ergonomic parameters are essential to reduce drudgery. And manual methods for calculation of various ergonomic parameters and storing of reference values of, for these parameters for a variety of machine design for various operations in agriculture are not efficient. So there is a requirement to maintain an online database for reference values of these agronomic parameters. Also, if these parameters can be accessed in field condition, it will be more beneficial. Hence, an Android-based mobile app for agronomic assessment protocol for testing agriculture activities and machinery is required. So this is the flow diagram for the system. This is the app interface where one can use it. This is the raw manual data operations, and this is the raw data which is used by the equipment. So this app basically converts this data into a user-friendly way, and one can see the sequence of screens for this mobile app, which can be used by various researchers and the persons and the test labs for these equipments. These are various other. Basically, Ergon app is useful for workers as well as researchers and students who want to conduct their research on the weathery aspects of farmers. It has these features. It maintains database of reference values for various operations and machines, maintains database of users along with the test values, performs calculations for the derived parameters, export data to Excel file for further analysis, provides reports and recommendations. So, coming to the faculty awards and recognition, Dr. Rajni Jain has received the Dr. D.K. Desai Award for the best paper for the total factor productivity growth in Indian crops by the Indian Institute of Agriculture Economics. Myself and Dr. Karoda got the best general paper award for the online progress monitoring of agriculture sciences initiative. And in the Hindi group, Mr. Prasad Singh and S.N. Islam jointly received second prize. These are the copyright received by our division in various portals and mobile app. This mobile app is jointly developed with the IBRI. It developed in 9 different regional languages. These are the other software which have been developed by the division in this last 1 year, including the education portal, which is a portal consists of multiple online workflows for operationalizing various schemes of agriculture education division ICR, and it was launched by the Honorable Agriculture Minister on 8th March. Then we did extensive work on Krishi Kalyan Abhiyan 1, 2, and 3 mechanism for developed for the monitoring system for operationalization of 3 phases of Krishi Kalyan Abhiyan. We developed TMIS and for pond waste management system. These are 7 mobile apps available on the Google Play Store. We also have maintained one of the biggest data center in the ICR, and division has proven capability for that. And we have, these are the, some of the, these features, and basically more than 93 websites we are hosting across for all the ICR institutions. As far as research papers are concerned, we have published 23 papers, and these are the listing. One student, Ashish Kumar Pradhan, got the Nehru Memorial Award, ISRI. So total we have 136 students till now, and number of students getting degrees is 4. These are the number of students which are enrolled with us right now. Courses we have offered 32, credits 89, theory 62, and practical 17. 627. Faculty members, we have 15 and 13 are research guys. We have organized some training programs. These are this. We have also involved in one of the major activity of the ICR, which is Smart India Hackathon, wherein almost 47 teams across India from different engineering colleges worked, and we gave them the agriculture problems, which and then they solved it in the 36-hour long competition. Organized artificial intelligence in agriculture and mass complex. These are the some photographs.
Thank you, Dr. Sudeep Marwa. Thank you very much. So, again, I appreciate you.
To all the professors of different division under social sciences, I request now Assistant Chair for his expert remarks.
Good morning, Honorable Director IRI, Dr. Agrawal, Dr. Naresh, Honorable Dr. R.P. Singh. Friends, I would like to welcome on behalf of IRI, on my own behalf, Honorable Dr. R.P. Singh, Dr. A.K. Singh, Dr. Sharma, Dr. Jain, Dr. Man Singh, all professors, students,
I hope you will agree with me that the presentations were excellent. They were outstanding presentations. And all of them, you know, gave presentations in a very simple language. I remember that when I was working closely with the biological scientist, it's very difficult to work with, you know, these two sciences, social sciences and biological science, understanding languages of each other. The social scientists work more on symbols. They have models, they have economic tools. And the quality of the best social scientist is that he should understand symbols, but speak in words, so that they can effectively communicate with our biological scientists and also with the policy makers. So the social scientists are bridge between the researchers, policy makers, ground realities, and also with the society. So they have major role to play in an organization like IRI and also in many of these ICR institutions. So I congratulate all the professors, five professors, who dwelt on various aspects. It was a wealth of information. It's difficult to summarize. They covered range of issues, and all issues were of tropical interest, from pharma producer medicines to climate change, artificial intelligence to app-based applications, to various areas and designing. So various issues were covered in this in five presentations. I will also mention that I have listed down a few points which I would like to mention with you. So yes. So I personally enjoyed all these aspects, and I will mention that specifically these social scientists, that social scientists, you know, your studies were of topical interest. You were studying in the present, and you had also given what had happened in the past in view of what you have to do in the future, for the future plan. Our role as social scientists, or the group which we are working, to take our, you know, best of the technologies, link with the farming community, and give proper advice to the policy makers at the top table. Many a times our stakeholders may not be directly farmers. Many times our stakeholders may be the directly policy makers. We have to evolve mechanisms to how to interlink our approaches, to reveal our results in such a way, in a simple language, and these are based on evidences, not based on our perceptions. So most of the policies, you will realize that they are implemented based on the perceptions rather than having evidences. So our approach should be to have evidence-based research, so that we can have effective communication with the policy makers. We should also understand the psychology of our key decision makers, who are in the decision making positions. We understand their psychology. So what they want, in fact, what kind of approach they need. So we should not be loyal to them only. We should play the role of dharma also. So they, you know, we have to be loyal to the organization, loyal to the system, and also we should play role of the dharma. You know, loyalty, karna is known as for loyalty. And for dharma, Arjuna is known for dharma. So social scientists have to play both the roles. They should have karna, also they should have Arjuna. So both roles he or she has to play in effective implementation of any kind of program. The timely delivery of their research outputs is also very important. If you miss the train, I think you will miss everything. So timely deliverer, pushing button at right time, is the preconditions for the social science. It may not be necessary for other sciences, but it is necessary condition for the social scientists, pressing button at right time. So if the key challenge is before us, I think we should immediately provide solution to overcome that kind of solution. So friends, I do not have much to say. I will only say that the presentations were excellent. And all of you are waiting for next session, which is an important session for Hooker Award. And I will say that all the students who are getting degrees I would like to congratulate, and also I wish to congratulate to all the award winners, students, faculty members in various areas. I am so proud of the social science group of this division, this institution, that they have making significant contribution in various areas. We are proud of your contribution. I know that you have made presentations, as I was mentioning, in a very, very simple language before, you know, biological scientists. And when you make presentation in professional society, you have all the jargons, you have all the symbols. So this is the beauty I can see of all the social scientists. So with this, I compliment all of you and congratulate all of you for the contribution. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable and encouraging remarks. Now it's the time to extend a warm gratitude to the esteemed chair. I request our honorable director, Dr. A.K. Singh, to kindly do the honor of presenting a shawl and a memento to the esteemed chair of the session, Dr. B.K. Joshi.
Last time I requested that we should get rid of this.
And we'll be joining back within 10 minutes for the important lecture, whether it's been or not.